From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
I think that Trump's election rigging talk is code word for too many black and brown people voting. When he talks about monitoring the polls in certain communities, in certain areas, when he complains about too many people voting, we know what he's talking about.
As President Trump signs an executive order to create a presidential advisory commission on election integrity, we'll look at how it could lead to massive voter suppression and help Republicans stay in power. Then we take a look at the case of Barrett Brown, a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist recently released after 4 years in prison.
The Barrett Brown case is probably one of the most significant threats to press freedom that has happened in the United States in the last, I would say, two decades at least.
In a Democracy Now! Exclusive, we speak with the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Glenn Greenwald and Barrett Brown himself, still under house arrest in Dallas. Then we look at Black Mama's Bailout Day, an effort to raise money to free as many African-American women from jail as possible before Mother's Day. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Trump has once again changed his story about why he fired FBI Director James Comey, now admitting on NBC he made the decision in part due to Comey's probe of Russia's meddling in the 2016 election.
But regardless of recommendation, I was going to fire Comey, knowing there was no good time to do it. And in fact, when I decided to just do it, I said to myself, I said, you know, this Russia thing with Trump and Russia is a made-up story. It's an excuse by the Democrats for having lost an election that they should have won.
President Trump's comment directly contradicts numerous statements by White House aides in recent days, as well as Trump's own claims that he'd fired Comey over his handling of the investigation into Hillary Clinton and her use of private email servers. According to the New York Times, Comey was fired just days after requesting more resources for his probe into the Russia-Trump campaign connection. During the same NBC interview, Trump also called Comey a showboat and claimed the FBI is in turmoil under his watch.
Look, he's a showboat. He's a grandstander. The FBI has been in turmoil. You know that. I know that. Everybody knows that. You take a look at the FBI a year ago. It was in virtual turmoil less than a year ago. It hasn't recovered from that.
The White House has also claimed people within the FBI had lost confidence and trust in Comey. But on Thursday, the acting FBI director, Andrew McCabe, rejected these claims when questioned by New Mexico Democratic Senator Martin Heinrich at a Senate Intelligence Committee hearing.
We've heard in the news that claims that Director Comey had lost the confidence of rank-and-file FBI employees. You've been there for 21 years. In your opinion, is it accurate that the rank-and-file no longer supported Director Comey?
No. No, sir. That is not accurate. Director Comey enjoyed broad support within the FBI and still does to this day.
White House officials have abandoned a plan for Trump to visit the FBI headquarters within the coming days after being told the president would not be welcomed or well-received at the agency. New details also have emerged about how Trump summoned Comey for a private dinner in January and reportedly demanded Comey pledge his loyalty to Trump. The New York Times reports Comey promised Trump honesty instead. The White House has rejected this account. President Donald Trump signed an executive order Thursday creating a so-called Presidential Advisory Commission on Election Integrity. The White House says the commission will be tasked with investigating voter fraud, but critics say it'll be wielded to enact policies that further suppress the vote. Trump appointed Vice President Mike Pence as the chair and Kansas Secretary of State Kris Kobach as the vice chair of the commission. Kobach, known as a leading proponent of anti-immigrant and voter suppression laws, was a key figure in drafting Arizona as notorious anti-immigrant racial profiling law SB 1070, known as the Show Me Your Papers law, parts of which have been found unconstitutional. He's pushed for the strictest voter identification laws in the country and advocated for a proof of citizenship requirement at the state and federal levels. We'll have more on the Voting Commission after headlines with The Nation's Ari Berman. Attorney General Jeff Sessions has released a memo telling Justice Department prosecutors to pursue the most serious charges for drug offenses. He also rescinded two Obama-era memos that encourage prosecutors to avoid seeking inordinately harsh sentences for low-level drug offenses. Sessions has long backed lengthy prison sentences and mandatory minimum sentences for drug crimes, including for marijuana use, which is now legal for either medical or recreational purposes in many states. The Senate has approved Robert Lighthizer to be the U.S. Trade Representative. He served as Deputy Trade Representative during the Reagan administration. He's a proponent of trade tariffs and has been a vocal critic of China. Angry town halls are continuing around the country, including in Iowa, where Republican Congressman Rod Blum faced four straight nights of hostile crowds this week, as hundreds of people showed up to events in Dubuque, Cedar Rapids, Cedar Falls and Marshalltown to jeer, boo and interrogate Blum about his support for backing of President Trump and the Republican health care plan. This is Iowa resident Dale Todd speaking alongside his son, who has epilepsy, at a town hall in Cedar Rapids on Tuesday.
And I would have thought somewhere along the line, somebody would have said that when you impact kids with special needs, who we sort of have an obligation to take care of our own here in Iowa, that we would have thought that maybe we shouldn't be doing that. And so I'm just trying to fathom where that motivation comes from.
In Iraq, the Journalistic Monitoring Group Air Wars says at least 35 civilians were reportedly killed and 100 more wounded in airstrikes carried out by either the U.S.-led coalition or the U.S.-backed Iraqi Air Force on Tuesday. Air Wars also says more strikes likely carried out by the U.S.-backed Iraqi Air Force reportedly killed another 27 people in Anbar province, also on Tuesday. In Argentina, tens of thousands of people poured into the streets Wednesday to protest a Supreme Court ruling in favor of a member of a dictatorship-era paramilitary group who was convicted of kidnapping and torturing people during Argentina's so-called Dirty War. The ruling could have reduced the sentences for those convicted of crimes committed under the dictatorship, but in response to public outcry, the Argentine Congress passed a law to block the shortening of their sentences. In Greece, pensioners and workers blockaded the entrance of the finance ministry Thursday to call for a general strike May 17th to protest a new round of austerity measures imposed by international creditors and accepted by the Greek government. This is one of the protesters, a 65-year-old pensioner.
The amount of harm that has been done to the Greek people by all these policies is unbelievable. A battle must be waged. What else can we do? We cannot do anything else.
A new report by the International Institute for Strategic Studies says Mexico endured the second most conflict deaths of any country last year, with a staggering 23,000 people killed amidst the country's so-called war on drugs. Mexico was second only to Syria, where 50,000 people were killed in 2016 by the ongoing war. The third, fourth and fifth most dangerous countries were Iraq, Afghanistan and Yemen. In New York State, residents are celebrating a major victory after Texas-based company Crestwood Midstream announced it's nixing plans to expand a natural gas storage facility and abandon salt caverns at Seneca Lake, a drinking water source for 100,000 people. The project has faced years of sustained resistance from local residents. More than 650 teachers, health workers, faith leaders, scientists, military veterans and others have been arrested blockading construction and protesting the project during the years-long campaign. Following this victory, residents say they're still committed to fighting Crestwood's separate plans for a propane storage facility in the area. To see our full coverage of the Seneca Lake struggle over the years, go to democracynow.org. Meanwhile, in California, students at the University of California, Santa Barbara, have scored a victory after Chancellor Henry Yang backed the students' calls for the university system to divest from fossil fuels. The backing came after hundreds of students participated indicted in a sit-in at the chancellor's office this week. Meanwhile, the $3.8 billion Dakota Access Pipeline has already had its first leak, and the pipeline is not even yet in operation. The 84-gallon oil spill occurred in Tulare, South Dakota, about 200 miles south of the site of the massive resistance camps in North Dakota, where thousands of indigenous people and their allies camped out in efforts to block the construction of the part of the pipeline that crosses the Missouri River. Florida University will be awarding Trayvon Martin with a posthumous degree in aeronautical science in a ceremony with his parents on Saturday. The degree aims to honor the African-American teenager's dream of becoming a pilot, where he was murdered before he was murdered by white neighborhood watch vigilante George Zimmerman in 2012. And in San Diego, California, social justice activist and priest Thomas Melville has died at the age of 86. He was one of a group of Catholic activists who became known as the Catonsville Nine. After 1968, they broke into a draft board office in Catonsville, Maryland, stole 378 draft cards and burned them in the parking lot as a protest against the Vietnam War. Others involved in the action were his wife, Marjorie Melville, and the late Berrigan brothers, Daniel and Phil Berrigan. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Voting rights activists are expressing alarm after President Donald Trump signed an executive order Thursday creating a presidential advisory commission on election integrity. The move comes after Trump repeatedly claimed that Hillary Clinton won the popular vote in November because between 3 and 5 million people voted illegally. No evidence has ever been presented backing up his claim. On Thursday, Deputy White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders unveiled the plan for the new election integrity commission.
I'd like to announce that the president also just signed another executive order establishing the bipartisan Presidential Advisory Commission on Election Integrity. The commission will review policies and practices that enhance or undermine the American people's confidence in the integrity of federal elections and provide the president with a report that identifies system vulnerabilities that lead to improper registrations and voting.
Civil rights groups and several Democratic lawmakers denounced the Election Integrity Commission, suggesting it's designed to perpetuate the myth of voter fraud as a pretense for new policies that'll make it harder to vote, policies such as voter ID laws, eliminating early voting and prohibiting same-day voter registration. Particularly worrying to voting rights activists is the selection of Kansas Secretary of State Kris Kobach as the vice chair of the commission. Kobach has pushed for the strictest voter identification laws in the country and advocated for a proof of citizenship requirement at the state and federal levels. Meanwhile, a new report has called into question whether President Trump would have actually won Wisconsin during the 2016 presidential election without the state's strict voter ID law. The study published by the progressive advocacy group Priorities USA says the law suppressed the votes of more than 200,000 residents, the majority of whom were African-American and Democratic-leaning. President Trump won only about 23,000 more votes than Hillary Clinton in Wisconsin. Well, for more, we're joined by Ari Berman, senior contributing writer for The Nation, where he covers voting rights. His recent piece is headlined, "Trump's Commission on Election Integrity Will Lead to Massive Voter Suppression." Explain why, Ari.
Well, I think it's—first off, it's important to note, this is not an election integrity commission. This is a voter suppression commission, because there is no evidence of widespread voter fraud to investigate. Everyone who's looked at this, including Trump's own lawyers, during the recounts in Michigan and other states, have said that the election was not tainted by fraud. So the only reason to do this and the only reason to announce it this week, other than to soothe Trump's ego, other than to distract from the news about Comey and Russia, is to perpetuate the myth of voter fraud in order to lay the groundwork for policies that will suppress the vote.
So explain what the commission is all about, how it came about, what its history is, and what exactly it's going to do.
So I guess you could say the roots of it happened after the election, when Trump startled everyone by saying that he would have won the popular vote, except for the fact that millions of people voted illegally. He's subsequently tweeted this. He subsequently said it. He's provided no evidence for these claims. And so it's an attempt, just like what he said about wiretapping. There was no evidence of it. Then he calls for an investigation. And so basically, he manufactured this issue. There was no evidence. And now we have an entire presidential commission designed to investigate it. There's going to be taxpayer money. Some of the heaviest hitters in the Republican Party are part of this commission. And I think it's easy to just dismiss it as another laughable thing that Trump is doing to try to distract from the news. But the real worry here is that they're going to say all of these outlandish things about voter fraud. It's going to have the veneer of a presidential commission, and then they're going to say, oh, by the way, there's all this voter fraud, and now we should pass strict voter ID laws. We should pass proof of citizenship laws. We should cut early voting. We should purge the voting rolls. We shouldn't just do it in the states where it's already happening. We should do it on the national and federal level as well. So the president of the United States endorsing a policy of voter suppression is absolutely chilling.
So, as you said, in January, President Trump called for this major investigation of voter fraud as he continued to falsely assert he lost the popular vote to Hillary Clinton because 3 to 5 million unauthorized votes were cast in the election. So, ABC anchor David Muir questioned Trump about those claims.
When you say, in your opinion, millions of illegal votes, that is something that is extremely fundamental to our functioning democracy, a fair and free election.
Sure.
You say you're going to launch an investigation into this.
Sure, done.
What you have presented so far has been debunked. It's been called false.
Take a look at the Pew reports.
I called the author of the Pew report last night, and he told me that they found no evidence of voter fraud.
Really? Then why did he write the report?
He said no evidence of voter fraud.
Excuse me. Then why did he write the report, according to Pew report? Then he's groveling again. You know, I always talk about the reporters that grovel when they want to write something that you want to hear, but not necessarily millions of people want to hear or have to hear.
So that's Donald Trump. Kansas Secretary of State Kris Kobach defended Trump's unfounded claim that millions of people illegally voted, supposedly costing Trump the popular vote. This is Kobach being questioned by reporters.
I think the president-elect is absolutely correct when he says the number of illegal votes cast exceeds the popular vote margin between him and Hillary Clinton at this point.
What tangible evidence is there that that actually happened?
Well, this is the problem with aliens voting and aliens registering. There's no way you can look on the voter rolls and say, this one's an alien, this one's a citizen, this one's an alien. Once a person gets on the voter rolls, you don't have any way of easily identifying them as aliens. And so you have to rely on post-election studies, like the Cooperative Congressional Election Survey, where you get data from aliens themselves saying, oh, yeah, I voted. It does appear that aliens do vote in very large numbers.
That was Kris Kobach back in November, right after the election, Ari Berman.
So all of the available evidence shows that voter fraud is a very small problem in American elections, and that non-citizens voting is an even smaller problem in American elections. Because just think about it, Amy. If you're a non-citizen and you vote, you're risking deportation, you're risking a felony, you're risking never being able to vote again if you become a U.S. citizen. So all of these things are a huge risk to somebody. And people who are here either illegally or here legally but are non-citizens, the last thing they want to do is vote and get deported. So this doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Just the numbers that we have show that in the 2016 election, the Washington Post found only 4 documented cases of voter fraud out of 135 million votes cast. It was 0.00002% of total votes. State-based reviews since then have found at most a few hundred alleged cases of voter fraud, not millions. In Kansas, Kris Kobach is the only Secretary of State in the country with the power to prosecute voter fraud cases. He's only convicted 9 people of voter fraud since 2014 out of 1.8 million registered voters in that state. He's only convicted 1 non-citizen of voting. So if this problem was as widespread—
Did they vote for Trump?
There was a different non-citizen who voted in Texas, not knowing that she was unable to vote. Because usually this is what it is. If you're a non-citizen and you vote, it's usually because you believe you're qualified, because you have documents like a green card or like a driver's license, and you believe that you're part of the political process. And they may ask you at the DMV, do you want to register to vote? And you say yes, but it's nothing nefarious here. There was another case of someone who voted twice in Iowa for Donald Trump because she believed his claims that the elections were going to be rigged. So I'm not saying this never happens, but it's a very, very, very small problem. And usually it's human error, not some sort of massive conspiracy underway.
Last year, Republican Congressman Glenn Grothman of Wisconsin made headlines with his comments about Wisconsin's controversial new voter ID laws, which prevented thousands of registered voters from casting ballots in Wisconsin's primary. Speaking to NBC, Grothman admitted he believed the state's voter ID laws would give the Republican presidential candidate an advantage during the upcoming general election. He was questioned by Charles Benson of NBC.
Take me forward to November. You know that a lot of Republicans since 1984 in the presidential races have not been able to win in Wisconsin. Why would it be any different for Ted Cruz or a Donald Trump?
Well, I think Hillary Clinton is about the weakest candidate the Democrats have ever put up. And now we have photo ID, and I think photo ID is going to make a little bit of a difference as well.
That was Republican Congressman Glenn Grothman of Wisconsin speaking last year. A new report has called into question whether President Trump would have actually won Wisconsin during the 2016 presidential election without the state's strict voter ID law. The study was published by the progressive advocacy group Priorities USA. It says the law suppressed the votes of more than 200,000 residents, the majority of whom were African-American and Democratic-leaning. President Trump won only about 23,000 more votes than Hillary Clinton in Wisconsin. Talk about this.
So I wrote about this study this week, and what they found was that overall turnout increased by 1.3% in 2016 over 2012. But states that adopted strict voter ID laws, turnout dropped by 1.7%, and it dropped in Wisconsin by 3.3%, so much greater decrease than the national turnout increase. And what they found, this study, was that 200,000 more people would have voted in Wisconsin if not for their strict voter ID law. Trump only won the state by 23,000 votes. The largest drop-off was among Black and Democratic-leaning voters. So they not only compared Wisconsin to other states, they compared it to states like Minnesota, right next door, which have very similar demographics and turnout rates. And they found that there was a much larger drop-off in Wisconsin than Minnesota, which does not have a voter ID law, that counties with a large African-American population had a larger drop-off. So this is yet another study showing that voter ID laws suppress the vote. And my feeling is these laws are bad regardless of if they impact an election, because we're making it harder to vote for no reason. But in Wisconsin, we have a very clear case study that this law impacted the final results of the presidential election.
The significance of the timing of the commission 2 days after Trump fired FBI Director James Comey, and also, you have Pence and Kobach as the heads of it.
Well, clearly this is an attempt to try to distract from the news. Voter fraud is something that plays to Trump's base. When people were testifying before Congress, FBI experts, they said one of the things the Russians did, one of their, quote, active measures in the presidential election was to raise doubts about the legitimacy of the election. So this is something that Trump always dusts off when there's some sort of controversy. And if you just look at the people who are leading it, Mike Pence is from Indiana, the first state to adopt a strict voter ID law, which started this whole voter suppression craze. In 2016, the state police in Indiana shut down a voter registration group, raided the office of a group that was registering Black and low-income voters, which had a chilling effect on voter registration there. You look at Chris Kobach, the Kansas Secretary of State, who's the vice chair of the commission. He is the leading figure within the Republican Party behind voter suppression efforts, behind anti-immigrant efforts. He is a very, very, very powerful, very, very dangerous figure within the Republican Party. Making him the vice chair of this commission shows that it's designed for one purpose, which is to try to suppress the vote.
Very quickly, we have less than a minute, but the fact that the census director has now quit, can you talk about the significance of this?
It's very significant because the census determines who is counted, literally, who is counted in terms of congressional representation, who is counted in terms of people getting resources, federal money, government programs. Often, Blacks, Latinos, Asian Americans, low-income voters are undercounted already by the census. So if the census has no money, you're going to see a further lessening of representation, a further lessening of minorities, low-income people counting in society. So it's one of those under-the-radar things that has a big impact on democracy.
And it determines how many candidates, how many Congress members represent a state.
Absolutely. It literally determines who is and who isn't counted. So if the census isn't getting money, if the census director resigns, and this is all being done in 2020 when there's going to be a whole new round of redistricting after the presidential election, it's very significant.
Well, Ari Berman, I want to thank you for being with us. Senior contributing writer for The Nation, where he covers voting rights. His recent piece will link to Trump's Commission on Election Integrity will lead to massive voter suppression. Ari Berman is the author of Give Us the Ballot, The Modern Struggle for Voting Rights in America. When we come back, an exclusive Democracy Now! Interview. Stay with us.
I can hear her heartbeat from 1,000 miles. And the heavens open every time she smiles. And when I come to her, that's where I belong. Yet I'm running to her like a river song. She gave me love, 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 crazy love. She gave me love. When I'm feeling low down, and when I come to her, when the sun goes down, she takes away my troubles.
Crazy Love, Instant Love, covered by Irma Thomas here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman as we turn to investigative reporter Barrett Brown, who recently completed a 4-year prison sentence related to the hacking of the private intelligence firm Stratfor, which exposed how the firm spied on activists on behalf of corporations. At one point, Brown faced 100 years in prison before pleading guilty to lesser charges, including transmitting threats, accessory to a cyber attack, and obstruction of justice. Supporters say Brown was unfairly targeted for investigating the highly secretive world of private intelligence and military contractors. Prior to his arrest, Brown appeared in the documentary We Are Legion and talked about the importance of information obtained by hackers.
Some of the most important things that have been have had the most far-reaching influence and have been the most important in terms of what's been discovered, not just by anonymous, but by the media in the aftermath, is a result of hacking. That information can't be obtained by the traditional journalistic process, or it can't be obtained or won't be obtained by a congressional committee or a federal oversight committee. For the most part, that information has to be, you know, obtained by hackers.
In 2009, Barrett Brown created Project PM, which was, quote, dedicated to investigating private government contractors working in the secretive fields of cybersecurity, intelligence, and surveillance. He was particularly interested in the documents leaked by WikiLeaks and Anonymous. In 2011, the group Anonymous hacked into the computer system of the private security firm HB Gary Federal and disclosed thousands of internal emails. Barrett Brown was not accused of being involved in the hack itself, but he did read and analyze the documents, eventually crowdsourcing the effort through the Project PM. One of the first things he discovered was a plan to tarnish the reputations of WikiLeaks and the journalist Glenn Greenwald, who would later win a Pulitzer Prize for his reporting on NSA whistleblower Edward Snowden. While serving in prison, Barrett Brown won the 2016 National Magazine Award for columns and commentary for columns he wrote for The Intercept. He was released from prison earlier this year, but was unexpectedly rearrested late last month, one day ahead of a scheduled interview for an upcoming PBS documentary. Barrett Brown was detained for 4 days and then released without receiving any formal written explanation for the arrest. Despite pressure from authorities not to speak to the media while under house arrest, Barrett Brown has opted not to keep silent. Democracy Now!'s Nermeen Sheikh and I spoke to him earlier this week, along with Glenn Greenwald, who was in our New York studio. I began by asking Barrett Brown why he was imprisoned for 4 years.
The FBI's original search warrants came out after we had, you know, begun documenting the DOJ and FBI's illegal involvement with intelligence contractors against journalists and activists. The search warrants stated that they were looking for information on HB Gary, one of the firms, as you mentioned, that had been involved in these crimes, in-game systems, another firm we were looking at, and our echelon2.org wiki on which we compiled this research. Later on, they charged me with entirely different crimes involving the Stratfor hack, which had already occurred and, you know, before the original search warrants. They were just looking for something to get me on that wouldn't involve going into some of these more nefarious projects that they were, you know, indirectly involved in. So I eventually fled to, after they dropped a number of very bizarre charges involving linking to information after a public outcry, I pled guilty to interference with a search warrant, threatening a federal agent, and accessory after the fact for having called the executive of Stratfor and offering to redact sensitive information. So that was the what they got me on eventually. So I did 4 years, first a low security, then a medium security federal prison, documented further abuses by the BOP. You know, spent about 6 months altogether in the hole or the shoe of that 4 year period. And, you know, did what I could to try to show people how the prisons operate, the extent to which due process violations are very common and hard to defend against. That none of that really came to anything, obviously. You can only document so much in a culture like this and expect anything to happen from it. And it's sort of a difficult culture to actually really get journalism to work in.
And Barrett, could you tell us what reason you were given, if any, for your rearrest?
Before I was arrested, the BOP had been claiming that I was not allowed to do interviews without their permission, which I happen to know is false. It's actually documented very clearly in the Bureau of Prisons program statement on media contacts, which I've linked to in a recent E! Magazine piece, that there is no such stipulation. Even inmates in the prisons can talk to journalists via the phone or mail without permission. The only aspect of that that requires permission is if the journalist wants to come into an actual prison on a certain day and interview an inmate at that prison. The BOP was trying to get me to force PBS and Vice Television to fill out these forms, which were completely inappropriate. I told them I wouldn't do it until they showed me a program statement saying otherwise. And then I recorded conversations with the local BOP regional representative, Luz Lujan, in which they threatened me with refusing an order charge if I refused to sign these legally ascertained documents. So the next day I was arrested by the federal marshals, held for 4 days. A law firm, Boons and Hain, hired by one of my other publishers, Wick Allison for D Magazine, threatened the BOP, said they would go to a court and challenge the terms of my confinement. And I was immediately released after that.
Had you been informed, Barrett, at all that you were not permitted to speak to the media?
Well, they were telling me that, and I recorded the conversations in which these BOP officials and the Halfway House staff tried to tell me that. And as I've said in the recordings, there's no such dictate in the program statements. And unless, you know, I'm shown a program statement saying I don't have a right, I'm going to exercise that right. And I'm certainly not going to help them force media outlets to seek prior restraint authorization from a random BOP official before doing their job. That's contrary to a number of principles, not just journalists have, but you know, that go straight to the heart of the First Amendment. And again, it's not legal. It's not a power they have. And but they knew they could get away with holding me for a few days in prison without any long-term consequences. And they're probably right. This is a prison issue in one way, but it's a larger issue of the rule of law and whether or not it actually exists, which I tend to claim that it doesn't.
Barrett Brown, you've said that you're considering taking asylum overseas after being re-imprisoned.
Yes. You know, I've been covered quite a bit in the press, especially when I was involved in Anonymous back in 2011. Sometimes over really silly things, inconsequential things, but, you know, things that were kind of lurid and exciting and perhaps seemingly romantic. In this case, even after I made very clear and did my best to document that a extraordinary crime against the First Amendment and against journalists, not just me, but other journalists, have been committed, there was really no press coverage other than from outlets like The Intercept and D Magazine that I write for, a few independent outlets as well. It just, the BOP and the DOJ and the FBI can operate beyond the law to a pretty high extent, especially when dealing with activists. And I'm going to continue to do my activism work. I'm going to continue to try to organize citizens against state criminality, but I can't do that from here, without being, arrested, by any official who chooses to do so. I have no problem doing prison time or being oppressed, in the public eye if it helps, but it just doesn't help that often. It just doesn't lead to anything. This is not the kind of society in which people say, oh, no, something terrible has happened. Let's act on it. They just don't. In Germany, a few years ago, what really impressed me is when a state prosecutor was found to have been investigating a news website that had been publishing leaked documents. And after that came to light, there were several days of marches, and 3 days after that, the prosecutor was out. That would never happen in the U.S., and that's the kind of country I want to live in, with people who I share some degree of decency with.
Can you just freely leave?
After my probation is finished, which will be at the maximum 2 years from now, but more likely 1 year, I guess I'll be able to leave the country, at which point I'll be giving up my citizenship and applying for citizenship elsewhere.
Well, Barrett Brown, by analyzing the information from the HB Gary hack, you discovered the security firm's plan to undermine our guest journalist Glenn Greenwald's defense of WikiLeaks. One slide read, quote, "Without the support of people like Glenn, WikiLeaks would fold." HB Gary intended to spread disinformation to discredit both Glenn Greenwald and WikiLeaks. In the documentary We Are Legion, the director spoke to former HB Gary CEO Aaron Barr about these plans.
It seems like you're trying to attack a journalist here.
Yeah, and I don't want to talk too much more about Glenn Greenwald, but other than, you know, what I previously said is, there was never an intent to attack journalists. Not on my part. I should generalize that and to say that, I would never just outwardly attack a journalist, other than if I felt that there was a journalist in my mind that was acting unethically, that, that is that's a fair game for having a public discussion about.
So that was HB Gary CEO Aaron Barr speaking in the documentary We Are Legion. Barrett Brown, can you explain what HB Gary is and the significance of what happened?
Yeah, it was what they were doing was significant because we saw a number of contractors aligned with the DOJ going after private citizens in this very nefarious combination of state and corporate actors. The Bank of America, which was concerned with WikiLeaks, and the Chamber of Commerce, which was concerned with several left-wing activist groups, can go to the DOJ and did, and ask them, hey, can you help us go after our enemies? They're also citizens, but we don't like them, and you probably don't like them either. And the DOJ will say, okay, let's put you in touch with the Hunt and Williams law firm, and they'll arrange Palantir and HB Gary and Endgame Systems, and they'll set up a covert disinformation campaign, and they'll hack servers, and they'll try to set up activists on charges of fraud, and it'll be great. That's an extraordinary symptom of what's wrong with this country. I should note what's really important about all of this is that the Team Themis thing was actually stumbled upon by several different people at once. This was a great example, one of several great examples of crowdsourced journalism. Later on, we went on to document further abuses, both by HB Gary and by Palantir, show that Palantir was lying when they claimed that they, this was a low-level person only that was involved in this, and they didn't approve of it. But in fact, their chief counsel and a number of other employees were in on those emails. There were other projects as well that are also, I think, very indicative, not just in what it says about how the state operates with these interests, but also what they can do now. Persona management was one particularly frightening technology that involves fake online personas that the military, CENTCOM in this case, can operate. These are provided by private companies, which again turn around and sell them to whoever else, including foreign despots, immoral corporate actors across the world. We've seen this over and over again with additional hacks that have shown, how Tunisia, for instance, was being assisted by the French government in oppressing its citizens. We see a company called Corvus in D.C. that assists Bahrain in smearing dissidents. So crowdsourced journalism did, in this case, what mainstream journalists couldn't do, which was stay on this subject, go through all of these emails, even after the headlines were over, after the month of amusing for media aftermath from the actual hack was over. We kept on it. We created an array of sort of relationships that other journalists could come and look at and use as a starting point if they wanted to go after this larger story.
So, Glenn Greenwald, if you could comment on this, because you were a subject of this, explain more who HB Gary is and their attempts to discredit you and what it meant for you.
Well, let me just say that the Barrett Brown case is probably one of the most significant threats to press freedom that has happened in the United States in the last, I would say, two decades at least. And it's received remarkably little attention in the mainstream press because they only pay attention when they themselves are attacked. So Donald Trump attacks posts some childish insult about the media or calls them the enemy of the people, and it's wall-to-wall coverage in the New York Times and CNN. And yet here was Barrett doing some of the most intrepid and important journalism in the United States, digging into this incredibly opaque and powerful faction. And because of his journalism into those areas, that is what directly triggered this FBI investigation and the attempt to imprison him. And the reason he got so little support from media organizations defending his press freedom was because they only care about press freedom when it comes to large corporate media outlets that aren't actually threatening to the government. And this was a case where Barrett discovered extreme levels of wrongdoing and corruption, including this slide that said it wanted to destroy my reputation, to prevent me from continuing to defend WikiLeaks, talking about destroying the reputation of people who are activists against the Chamber of Commerce. He was doing incredibly important work. He's obviously a very talented journalist. The scribblings he did for us in prison on paper with pencil won the National Magazine Award for the columns that we published. And yet now he's saying, just like Laura Poitras felt when she had to edit her film Citizen Four, that he can't safely do journalism in the United States. So we love to talk about Russia and press freedoms there, even though we have no impact on it when we do. We spend very little time talking about the real threats to press freedom in this country because they happen to people like Barrett Brown rather than to MSNBC and the New York Times.
But explain why it mattered what H.B. Gary was saying, this information coming out, for example, on you.
Well, these contractors that very few people have heard about, including H.B. Gary, I had never heard of them until this happened, or Palantir, the organization funded by the billionaire Peter Thiel, exert extreme levels of power inside of this murky world of intelligence and defense contractors. And what they were planning to do was they were putting a pitch together to Bank of America using the firm Hutton and Williams, which is this powerhouse in D.C., to try and tell the Bank of America, which at the time thought it was going to be the target of a WikiLeaks disclosure, let us use our dark arts and dirty little tactics to destroy the people who will be your critics. And that was the plan they were putting together that Anonymous discovered and Barrett reported on. And the only reason why it was discovered is because Anonymous randomly hacked into it. And what was amazing about it was there were dozens of people talking about these plans that were illegal or certainly unethical. And not one person ever said, wait a minute, isn't this going a little bit too far to destroy journalists for reporting on these events? That's how common this mentality is in that world and how much impunity there is for it. And that was what Barrett was on the verge of really uncovering at the time the FBI began trying to put him in prison.
Well, in an interview on Tuesday with the ACLU, you talked about, elaborated on the point you made now, about how the media itself persecutes its own sources and that journalists take the lead in advocating for policies that would restrict their own press freedom. So could you explain why you think that is? Because, of course, it's completely counterintuitive.
Right. You would think in just a normal, healthy democracy, you would have the government over here being adversarial to press freedoms, and then you would have journalists vehemently defending the power of the freedom of the press. That's how it's supposed to work. And yet, in so many cases, especially when the government targets journalists who aren't popular among or working within these mainstream outlets, not only do the journalists ignore it or acquiesce to these efforts to punish and criminalize and attack independent journalists, they become the leading cheerleaders. When I first started doing the Snowden reporting, it wasn't, you know, James Clapper or Keith Alexander going on TV calling for my imprisonment. It was David Gregory or Andrew Ross Sorkin or other journalists who work at the New York Times, someone with an institution with a history of defending press freedom. And so that is a huge problem, is because so many mainstream journalists in the United States identify not with journalism, but with serving the interest of the U.S. government and the national security state, they become the leading spokespeople, the leading advocates for the right to criminalize journalism. The U.S. government doesn't have to defend trying to put Julian Assange in prison for publishing documents. Journalists are happy to take the lead in arguing that that should happen, even though that will directly threaten them.
them.
Has that changed at all under Trump? Now that Trump has called the media the enemy of the people, the enemy of the American people, the media has found its backbone in some cases.
Definitely.
Do you think that will extend to what you're describing?
No, unfortunately, I don't. And if you notice, there are certain lines that the quote-unquote resistance, including the media, won't cross. So, for example, when Trump bombed Syria with no congressional authorization and no plan, the media largely cheered. When he dropped the so-called mother of all bombs in Afghanistan, the largest bomb short of a nuclear weapon in Afghanistan, the media cheered. And now that the CIA and Jeff Sessions are threatening to prosecute WikiLeaks and Julian Assange under the Espionage Act for publishing documents, you have major media figures, simply because they hate WikiLeaks and are incredibly short-sighted, supporting Jeff Sessions, supporting Mike Pompeo in the idea that WikiLeaks' publication of documents should be criminalized, even though that can then be turned around and used against them. So, no, they place off-limits certain policies that are really dangerous, even if Trump is the one advocating them.
Hmm. I'm wondering, Barrett Brown, if you would do anything differently, given that you ended up in jail for 4 years?
No.
And I'm wondering your thoughts on Donald Trump firing James Comey, the FBI director. To say the least, you had a lot of dealings with the FBI.
There was a great deal of disingenuousness in the argument over the last year over the Clinton investigation on both sides. You know, I watched Comey testify before Congress regarding the Clinton decision from a federal prison with other federal inmates. All of us had been pursued at some point, sometimes multiple times, by the FBI and other federal agencies. And when he said that we treat everyone the same, there was, you know, audible laughter in the audience there. The FBI, first of all, no one can really say one way or the other what the FBI does. There is no broad set of procedures. Individual FBI agents and individual prosecutors across the country largely act as they feel is appropriate in a particular situation. FBI agents lie on the stand pretty routinely. In my case, you can see them trying to present something that Bob Beckel on Fox News said about killing Assange as something that I had said, which is obviously bizarre for several reasons. You can just see over and over again that there's no negative feedback to the system. There's no reason why a prosecutor shouldn't lie or withhold evidence, as they did in my case. There's no reason why the FBI shouldn't pick and choose who they prosecute or who they, you know, go after, you know, just based on ideological, personal, or the haphazard factors. That's quite extensive. Obviously, my mother was indicted for obstruction of justice, for hiding my laptops in her kitchen cabinet when there was not yet a warrant for her house. So Clinton, Hillary Clinton, had she been someone else, you know, probably would have been indicted. Having said that, George W. Bush and many of his administration, had they been other people, had there not been a political element there or sort of an establishment sort of back-scratching ethos whereby we really don't go after powerful people, you know, they would have been indicted as well, had they been just regular people. So the fact is, none of these people know, none of these people in the Senate and Congress really know what's normal for the FBI. There is no normal, other than a degree of disingenuousness that kind of changes from case to case. DOJ, same thing. None of these people who were so upset about the DOJ, about Loretta Lynch, meeting with Clinton, which, of course, is an extraordinarily egregious act, you know, none of them were really upset about when the DOJ, again, was conspiring to go after journalists and activists in a way that just not only goes against their charter, but goes against the entire reason for being. There's a great dance of disingenuousness that goes on in our national dialogue, and part of it's wrapped up in the establishment's regard for other establishment figures, whether they be in journalism or law enforcement or politics. And part of it just has to do with the deterioration of how we think as a society, what kind of people make it to the top, what kind of people lead our national conversation. And it's a huge, all-encompassing, fundamental problem, and it's all the more dangerous because this is such a powerful nation with such an extensive machinery that goes all across the world.
Barrett Brown, are you able to step foot outside? You're under house arrest.
I'm able to. I have to go in my front yard, I imagine. I'm supposed to be here unless I'm going to work or some other wholesome appointments. I really don't mind that. I'm kind of a homebody anyway. I'll be off home confinement in a few weeks. Then I'll be under the DOJ's probation department. Another good example of how haphazard this all is, the local probation department here in the Northern District of Texas is actually very kind, very, you know, they're run by sort of social worker types who wanted to get into this kind of business to help people. So it just goes to show how these institutions are, they're not monolithic. There's nothing you really say about them that they'll do this, they want to do this. It's all just comes down to, you know, when the rule of law doesn't really apply, when procedures can be violated at whim, both for good or ill, you're dealing with a big amorphous mass rather than some, you know, really pristine rule of law procedures that you can point to and say this is a wholesome system of governance. This is something we can, you know, we can definitely practice free speech on, but we can definitely expect that our rights will be maintained. It's more complicated than that.
Are you allowed to use a computer?
I am. That's debatable. The DOP representative, just like with their interview stipulation that they've now backed off of, originally claimed that under my terms of home confinement that I'm not allowed to use a computer, and they're basing that off of my terms of supervised release, which doesn't even start yet. That's my probation.
That's investigative journalist Barrett Brown speaking while under house arrest in Dallas, Texas. He recently served a 4-year prison sentence. And then when he was released a few weeks ago, he was rearrested and then inexplicably released. Also, we were speaking to Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Glenn Greenwald. When we come back, Black Mama's Bailout Day, an effort to raise money to free as many African-American women from jail as possible before Mother's Day. Stay with us. A poor single mother on welfare, tell me how you did it. There's no way I can pay you back, but the plan is to show you that I understand. You all appreciate it. Baby, don't you know it love is sweet? Dear mama, baby, place no one above you. You all appreciate it. Baby, don't you know it love is sweet? Now ain't nobody tell us it was fair. No love for my daddy, cause the coward wasn't there. He passed away and I didn't cry, cause my anger wouldn't let me feel for a stranger. They say I'm wrong and I'm heartless, but all along I was looking for a father, he was gone. I hung around with the thugs, and even though they sold drugs, they showed a young brother love. I moved out and started really hanging. I needed money of my own, so I started slanging. I ain't guilty, cause even though Dear Mama by Tupac, here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. This Sunday, Mother's Day, will be a lot happier for scores of women across the country. On Thursday, racial justice groups began bailing out women out of jail as part of a nationwide Black Mama's Bailout Day. The effort, taking place in nearly 20 cities, raises money to bail out as many Black women from jail as possible in time for a Mother's Day celebration with their families. This is a clip from the campaign video announcing the project.
Our corrupt criminal justice system forces innocent people who pose no threat to purchase their freedom. The costs are devastating. Women oftentimes lose their homes, jobs, or even children just to be found innocent. Some women, like Sandra Bland, have even lost their lives. Thousands of families go through this every day. This year, we're taking a stand.
Organizers for Black Mama's Bailout Day are calling for an end to the cash bail system, which keeps millions of people who have not been convicted of any crime imprisoned in jails every day nationwide while they await trial. Well, for more, we're joined by Mary Hooks, co-director of Southerners on New Ground, or SONG, an Atlanta-based regional LGBTQ nonprofit, one of the organizers of Black Mama's Bailout Day. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Mary. So lay it out. What are you doing leading up to Sunday?
Hello, friend. We have set out with a vision and an intention to bail out as many Black mamas as possible. We know that about 80% of Black women that are sitting in cages right now are single parents and caretakers. We know that the 1 out of 3 Black trans women who have spent time in the cage have experienced sexual violence in the cage. 1 out of 9 Black children have parents who are incarcerated. And so our goal is to be able to free our people from these cages using the traditions from our ancestors that bought each other's collective freedom, to get our folks back home and to highlight the crisis around the cash bail system, put pressure on all of these institutions who are making money off of our people suffering, but most importantly, restore the life that this cash bail system have taken from our people.
You spent much of yesterday at a jail in Atlanta with your team bailing out women. Can you describe the scene and how they responded?
My word. I get chills thinking about it. We were got there about 10 a.m. We left about 1 a.m. A crew of folks set up outside so we can make sure we had some immediate needs, gift bags, loose cigarettes, water, MARTA cards, love, music, packets of information to access direct services. We had therapists and nurses on site. And we also were able to, our first round of folks was about 7 people. And we had built such a rapport with the folks in the jail that when the women were when the women were coming out, we were in tears, they were in tears, and it was just amazing. And I think that's part of what we long to do inside of our work, is to organize from a place of desire and longing and love. And it was in the air.
Mary, can you explain what the cash bail system is and how it is so many women and men, I'll ask if you're doing the same thing on Father's Day, are held without having been convicted of a crime, but in jail?
Yes. Well, we have a system that says, you know, regardless if you know, if you don't have money and you're held pretrial, meaning you haven't been convicted, you haven't been tried, you haven't told your story, if for some reason you don't have enough money, you have to stay in the cage, and someone else who has money can pay money to get out. You have to stay in a cage and await your trial. Now, obviously, in certain states, there's a limitation on what a speedy trial looks like, but you look at cases like Khalif Browder, right, who sat in a cage 360 of those days in solitary confinement for over 2 years awaiting trial. And so we have folks who are sitting in cages, and literally after 3 days, after 2 days, 1 day is enough, who are losing their housing, their jobs, their children, because they cannot afford to pay the money in order to get out, be able to mitigate their cases, and be able to show back up to court. And so we're seeing up to 700,000 people daily languish in cages because they cannot afford bail. It is modern-day bondage. It is hostage. Our people are being held at ransom.
A new report by Color of Change and ACLU finds, quote, with little accountability, the for-profit bail industry has thus created a way to profit from usurping the role and function of the courts, trap families in debt while escaping scrutiny for consumer practices, made armed arrests and surveilled people without meaningful oversight by police, and evaded insurance regulators. Sandra Bland, of course, comes to mind, who was pulled over, the police officer said, for failing to signal a lane change and ends up dead in her jail cell because she couldn't raise the bond money to get out 3 days later. We're wrapping up with this comment, Mary Hooks. Mary, with your comment on women like Sandra and who you're trying to save.
You know, for women like Sandra, for women like Sandra, for women like myself, for the women like my family members and my comrades and folks who are, we are bailing out, for people who don't get killed by police in that interaction, the slow death happens in the cage. And so our hope is that this action inspires other folks to take action, to know that we can take down this cash bail system, to know we can get our people out of cages right now. There's a long-term fight ahead of us in terms of ending the cash bail system.
Mary, we're going to continue this discussion in the coming days. I want to thank you so much for being
with us.
Mary Hooks, co-director of Southerners on New Ground and an organizer of National Black Mamas Bailout Day. That does it for the show. I'll be speaking in New York tonight at the New School at Tishman Auditorium at 7 p.m., free to the public here in New York. On Saturday, it'll be in Olympia, Washington, and then at Powell's Books in Portland, Oregon. Sunday will be in Eureka and Berkeley. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks for joining us.